thanks, Allie. Can you hear me and everything? Hey, Ryan. Can you guys just give me a thumbs up if you can hear me? I had a little trouble logging in this morning. Great, thanks. Small delay. Okay, so I'm gonna go ahead and get started. I have a patient this morning, so I can't pontificate too much, but this is definitely a subject I can pontificate on. I even have notes, so I'll stay on task. So hopefully I won't run you guys behind or myself behind. So this morning, I'm your PT on ice. I'm representing the APHPT. For those of you that, let me start my timer. For those of you that saw the tweet and you're thinking this is about this is about food, it's not about food. So if you're disappointed, you can drop off now and we'll wait and maybe do something about food later on. This is about communication. And so the reason I titled it Hamburger with Cheese is I have a dear, dear friend, and her parents immigrated years ago, like right before Castro took over in Cuba. They kind of saw the writing on the wall, and so they came to the United States. They were young adults, and he did not know English, anything about the culture, and so he tells me the story one time about when he first got here, all he knew to order at a restaurant was a hamburger. Like, that's the only word he knew, so he ate a lot of hamburgers. God bless him. He ate a lot of hamburgers when he first came to the United States. And then he saw someone eating a hamburger with cheese on it. And so in his mind, he's putting it together, and he goes, you know, a long time ordering a hamburger with cheese. And to us, to an American, it's so funny. Like, would you ever go say, I'll have a hamburger with cheese? But what something I want you to think about as we talk about this communication issue is that wrong? Is it wrong that he ordered a hamburger with cheese rather than saying what we would say, which would be a cheeseburger? So that's just something I want you to roll around in your head. So it's communication versus education. And so are you communicating with your population or client? Are you educating them? And I would say that we tend to default to educate because that's how we're trained. We're always like, educate the patient. But it's truly like communication that we need. So a lot of times people say, or particularly the new clinicians or the younger clinicians that like to giggle at my ways, and they'll say, God, Perry, you have an analogy for everything. Like, why do you have an analogy for everything? And it's because I've spent 16 years communicating with people that I treat and not educating them. Because I learned really, really early, really possibly out of fear tactics from my mentor, that you have to communicate. It's something that, like, I went back and read, and it's been years since I read it. You guys probably don't even get this book anymore. Like, this is how I was trained in manual therapy. It was Maitland. You don't have to read it, but there is a fabulous chapter, if you can find the book, if they're not printing it anymore, on communication. And it occurred to me when I went back and read that book, I was like, oh my God, that's like what I've been doing the whole time. And maybe we've lost that. So the chapter in Maitland is talking about communication as far as choosing your next manual technique and is the client getting better. But it really drives home this message, which is when you communicate, it denotes helping, it denotes caring, It denotes action and it denotes a solution. Like you are there to communicate with the person or the group of people that you're talking to because you want to create a solution. Education doesn't do that. I mean, think about your professors. You're just kind of left in the lecture hall. You get this vomit of information and it's up to you to assimilate it. And so if we're going to move the needle on health, you can't just vomit the information on them. You have to communicate it. You have to give it action. And the way that you give it action is through effective communication. So that's real easy to say, like, let's all communicate better. But if you think about, like, what is communication? It's verbal and nonverbal. We all know that. But it's also the craziness in your head. So you have to kind of get over yourself before you can even verbally and non-verbally communicate well. So what is the communication in your head? So this means that a practitioner has to be very aware, and this came up, was it last weekend? Last weekend, what your biases are. And so I was in a group with a bunch of clinicians all, you know, different levels of education, all different age cohorts, from the very novice new clinician to, you know, very, very seasoned clinician. And we're all talking about cultural biases, like, what are our biases? And I'm sitting there going, like, what are your day-to-day, I almost said it, what is your day-to-day biases? And so you have to know what your day-to-day biases are. So yes, you can have cultural biases, and I think it's very, very important for you to kind of dive into that and figure out what your cultural biases are. But I'm here to tell you, you may have a food virus bias, a food virus. You may have a food bias. And so you may have, because we're all very healthy, And we all want to, you know, we want to die suddenly. We don't want to die in the ICU. When you are communicating with a client or a group of people and you are talking about food, your bias of how much you dislike someone who eats fast food will come out. That is your non-verbal communication. So, but if you know that before you enter into the conversation, you're not going to be perfect at it, but it's at least something that you've self-actualized, you're self-aware of it, and you will tame it a little bit. Because once that comes out, then they're checked out. They're not listening to you. And this came up last night. I was able to sit through the CERT class. You know, at the APHPT, it's a fundamentally different way to care, and at ICE, it's a fundamentally different way to learn. So we actually have the opportunity, after we've taken the CERT course, to sit in on the new cohort, which I think is a fabulous idea. And so I was sitting in, and they're battling this issue. They're battling this issue of communication versus education versus their own inherent biases. And so I just want everybody to understand that your biases can be so small and it will come out in your communication. So let me just, a day-to-day bias of mine, because I'm a manual therapist, is facet. Like, it's always facet. Oh, your problem is the facet. Like, I will stop listening to the spine patient because I am so biased to it being a facet problem. And so each time I see a new client, I have to prove that it's the facet last. Like, that's what I do to myself. I say, you know, Perry, you're going to rule out everything else. Like, you're going to just listen and you're going to take the time because you want to go to facet. And so those are your day-to-day biases that you need to understand. And that's in your head. Like, you got to get that out of your head. Because it's the nonverbal communication that is the most, like in the class last night, they were like, how do you move someone to change? And I will say the way that you move someone to change or help them get there is that nonverbal, authentic communication that is spontaneous that you don't even know that you're doing. So when you are realize that you're what your biases are, your tiny inherent biases, then you can be authentic enough to really, really connect with them and have them do something different in their life. And that's what the biases do. So that kind of leads me to health literacy. So let's talk about health literacy, because this education thing comes up. It's like, we've got to educate, we've got to patient education. Well, let's talk about, like, what is health literacy? So health literacy is like literacy. Like, what is your reading level? What is your comprehension level? You know, I have an 11-year-old and they don't do reading levels anymore. They do what's called a Lexile score. So like, what is your Lexile score? And so what Maitland will tell you is it's the least common denominator of the person that you're dealing with. And it doesn't mean you have to condescend to them, but what it does is that, and this is going to bring me back to hamburger with cheese, you do not correct them. Like, get over your own intelligence, okay? Because in order for someone to do something with their life, they need to understand it in their way, not your way. They don't care what you know. They don't even care about the degrees and the letters after your name. They just want to know that you listen and that you understand their form of communication. So this can go, so we always think about like health literacy on like a lower socioeconomic status and that we have to kind of come down. Well, that is not true, because I treat the majority of my patients are right, you know, educational level where I am, socioeconomic level where I am, but they don't understand anything that I'm saying. And case in point is, I'm about to go see another one right after this, as soon as I shut up talking, but you know, I live on the south side of Atlanta, so like when you're driving into the city, the first thing that you hit is the airport. So there's a lot of people here that work at the airport, and so I see a lot of pilots, and they are very, very bright, very smart. A lot of them are engineers. They don't understand a thing about their body. Oh my gosh, like, I can talk to them on the same level, but they understand flying very well. They don't understand health very well. And so even though that we're on the same education level, and I venture to say some of them are a lot brighter than I am, I have to use that language. So that's another thing about communication, is if you don't know, like if you're entering into a group and you don't know the language, you need to take some time to learn the language. So luckily for me, because I happen to have married one, like I have the language. And so the other day I had to say the term overcorrect. I was like, you're overcorrecting with that exercise. Prior to me saying that term overcorrect, he didn't understand what I was saying. And then finally I remembered, like, how can I tell him he's doing this wrong? He's recruiting wrong. And then I just said, hey, you're overcorrecting. And then boom, he got it just like that. So you can kind of swing over. So that's kind of a higher education. You can kind of swing over, and when I started practice, I was in the rural mountains of Georgia. And so they call everything leaders as far as their muscles are concerned. They call their muscles leaders. So they'll come in and they'll say, you know, I pulled one of the leaders in my leg. And so you don't correct them. Like, if they point to their quad, you say, you know, how does the leader feel when you do this? Like, you adopt their language, you don't correct them. And the funniest story is one time, this Jeff is going to die because I said this to him one time. One time I had a patient, this true story, and she I walked in and she said, "Oh my gosh, I'm so glad you're a woman. I thought you were a man based on what they told me your name was." And it was, and I was like, "Okay, that's great." And she said, "I just couldn't have a man." And I was like, "Well, what's going on?" And she said, "Well, I pulled my coochie muscle." And so, like, what do you do? So I just sat there and I'm thinking, "Oh my God, like, what is her coochie muscle?" You know? And so I'm thinking to myself, don't correct her, because that's how I was trained. Don't correct her. So I didn't correct her. And the fabulous thing about the body is most of the time we have two of everything. So I said, "Is it your right or your left coochie muscle?" And she said, "Oh my gosh, it's my right. See, I was doing this with my kids and I won't even tell you what it was because it's kind of crazy. But that's what it was." And so it was an instant connection. It ended up being her groin muscle. And I treated it. She trusted me and that was it. And I never told her. I never corrected her. And so those are the kind of things that you have to do. Oh, that's my timer. So the bottom line is, I think hamburger with cheese is fine. I would say, how was your hamburger with cheese? I like to add pickle to mine. And that is how you communicate rather than educate. You guys have a great rest of the Monday. Oh, is it Monday? It's Monday. See, we had snow in Georgia and I'm all screwed up. So yes, you guys have a great start of the week. Talk to you soon.